Trying to make me connect it through Facebook.
To Livestream?
Yeah, it won't let me chat with them on Facebook.
Does he need you on Facebook account?
Katie's are on screen talent.
Are we gonna have her talking?
Yeah.
Okay. Should I hear her back?
It still won't let me.
I'm logged in.
Yeah, but it still won't let me do it. It wants to be connected to
Facebook.
So the chat
has to be through Facebook.
Maybe. So we can moderate, we can delete people, but we can't write anything ourselves.
So maybe was Denise signing in with her personal account?
No, it's never required this of us before. So lights, camera, action.
We're announcing the winner today, right?
Yes,
we are. Winner has not been announced yet.
No.
Okay.
The winner has not been announced yet. We got about 5 minutes of film.
Sorry about that. Maybe what happened. Are you guys about to record?
Yeah, so if you can turn off a playback in the room.
Yes. Oh, awesome.
Okay, and
I have an idea.
What's your idea?
I'm going to leave the tripod here.
Yeah.
So when we start, I'll be good to just pop it back on.
Yeah.
And I'm just going to frame it out and do it at home.
Okay, right, we are live. We're on slideshow. We are about to go to Katie. Katie, if you can grab your microphone and get yourself comfortable. What's that?
Am I announcing Duke Redbird at the end?
I believe so.
Okay.
Do we want Katie to throw to Dr. Redbird? Okay, we're going to go live with Katie, and I just want to know I just want to confirm who we're having her go to. But I think it is who's speaking first at the podium. They haven't confirmed yet, but I'll whisper right on the back of the paper or something like that. Too. But you ready? Okay, your microphone's up, and switching to camera two.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Youth Solidarity Forum at the Art Gallery of Ontario in coordination with the Michaëlle Jean Foundation and World Pride. We also had over 50 other community contributors, and we would like to thank them as well. Today, we'll be announcing the 6 finalists of the Solidarity Program and announcing the final winner. So we would like to now give the floor over to Elder Duke Redbird. We would like to thank everyone for joining us. It's going to be an amazing day. We have a lot of speakers planned. We have some amazing performances from Unity and Sketch. We also have a fun photo booth. If you'd like to come and join us, you can definitely put on costumes and pose in our photo booth. And we would like to welcome everyone, and we hope that everyone has an amazing time at World Pride in general, but especially at the Art Gallery of Ontario. And thank you all of the artists who submitted all of their projects, and we hope that everyone can come down and see all of the 6 finalist pieces. And if you could hold on, we'll be right with you in about a minute. Thank you.
Beauty. Thank you.
I'm so sorry. I didn't have so much time to fill.
No, I should have been
there. I thought you should have been quick thing, and I was going to get cut off.
But stand by. Stand by.
No, it's great.
I thought it was
like 15 minutes. It's live.
Okay.
Live stuff is always.
Alright.
You actually see the 24 and you're like, and we'll lose forever. And we don't have it right now.
Alright. And now I have to fill that space. Alright. So now I'm prepared to fill space.
No, it's good for
Speak in French? None of us have the French very well.
I will try to speak
French. Yes. Okay, we are ready for an interview. So, ready, camera two. Mic's up, cutting to camera two.
Hello, welcome back. I was wondering if you could please introduce yourself and talk about your contribution to the Art Gallery of Ontario, and especially the Youth Solidarity Forum.
Hello, me. I come from Montreal. I am the VP of ATQ, Help for Trans of the Quebec. And I present here a PowerPoint of an exhibit we do around the Quebec last year or 2 years ago. The time passed too quick. We come from Paris. That's an exhibit about transsexuality. Transsexual who have good... you know, positive view, like they do things for the community, they are on TV or anything like that, you know, like Buck Angel, like Liati, the mannequin, a couple of others, and we had 23 pictures, yeah, like the size like that, in plexiglass mirror, you know what I mean by that? And that was really nice. We passed around the Quebec, and I think at least 15,000 people see the exhibit, and that was a good vibe, good information to see what the reality of transsexuality, where they are, and me, I'm there for that, the ATQ, for change the mentality about the transsexuality. And Denis Cormier from Fondation Emergence helped me with for the exhibit, because I'm not into art in my real life. I don't know much about the big art. So we had a subvention for the government for do that, homophobia, against homophobia. So that was really nice, and I enjoyed doing that, and I enjoyed to come here to present the exhibit.
That's amazing. And I was wondering if you could tell us more about the pieces in your exhibition, and what are the mediums perhaps? Are they photography based or painting based?
No, that was pictures. Big high quality pictures. On, like I say, on a plexiglass mirror, like really, really shiny. And that's about plenty photographer, famous photographer around the world. So
that sounds amazing. And how long is your exhibition on for?
The exhibition was for close to a year. Now that's finished. So sometimes people ask to us to bring the exhibit somewhere, and we bring it. And here, that's PowerPoint, but that's help at least.
Amazing! Thank you so much for your time, and thank you for joining us. And now we have Jasmine from Sketch. Thank you. Hello, Jasmine.
Hi.
Would you like to tell us about your involvement in the Youth Solidarity program, but especially what does Youth Solidarity mean to you?
Okay, so I'll start with that. Youth solidarity means young people coming together, banding together for a number of different causes, and just showing support and really connecting with each other. And at Sketch, I'm part of the Connect to Youth and Acting Out program, and so we're here actually running a workshop that shows the kind of work that we do within the community. So we go into different organizations that provide services for young people, and we work with the staff there with young people who have lived experiences and sharing their stories and offering some suggestions and trainings that will better improve the experience young people have when they go through the different systems.
That's amazing, and I love the fact that you talked about meeting youth where they are and getting their entry narrative and really understanding their story and then building upon that. Can you talk about what it was like working with Art Gallery of Ontario?
I actually didn't work directly with the Art Gallery of Ontario, so I can't really speak to that.
That's okay. So what's the feeling you get in the Art Gallery of Ontario, especially around youth solidarity and the community gallery, perhaps? What are the feelings you get?
It feels very vibrant and open and welcoming and exciting. Yeah.
Well, we are so happy to have Sketch here with us. Is there anything else you would like to say about your program?
Yeah, actually, we're holding auditions in August, so contact Sketch to find out more information about how to be a part of the Connect to Youth program.
Amazing. And what kind of auditions would it be? Like, what kind of things would you have to prepare for these auditions?
So you don't have to prepare for anything. Just come as you are. We, the Connect to Youth Acting Out program is a theater-based, drama-based program. And so we'll do informal interviews and just drama exercises to get people comfortable, get to know where people are at, and go from there. So it's very relaxed. Just come as you are and be prepared to play, really.
That sounds amazing. Can you give us the day for that and maybe the contact information again?
Yes. So you can email carrie@sketch.ca. And the auditions will start from July 30th. So just get in contact with us from July 30th, before July 30th.
Amazing. Thank you. Well. And now we have the elder and most honorable Duke Redbird, if you would like to join us in just a few moments. Thank you.
We're on camera one.
Excellent. Am I mounting now?
Yes.
Perfect. Yeah, that was awesome.
Camera one on you. Widen up, show me a little bit more room. Maddie, give me the podium. Whoever has Dr. Duke Redbird. The one that looks like an elder who's about to walk. Yes, find out who they are, what they look like.
Cool.
Can I just leave this here?
Yeah.
Okay.
What?
Oh shoot, what have I done to my
Yeah.
Notes?
Oh, I probably just grabbed them to the right.
Mine's not right here. No, sorry.
No, no, these are mine.
So we all get
checked. No problem, no problem.
What was that flash?
I think it's people outside.
So there's still a
picture. Yeah, it wasn't you guys.
Okay, he's walking now. We are ready to go in just a moment. So, if you want to like just do a bit of a hang in my interview for a while, or what you want to talk about, then you're going to be like, all right.
Sounds
Okay.
Good afternoon, everyone. I think we're about ready to begin. It's a great pleasure for me to be here today, join in with the event. And in keeping with First Nation traditions, I would like to share with you some of the history of the Mississauga First Nation of the New Credit, within whose territory the present city of Toronto is located. Now, this area was at one time a part of the vast extended territories of the Mississauga peoples. It was a gathering place where trade and social interaction occurred, and many diverse First Nation people found the area to be a natural meeting ground. In the tradition of the Mississauga people, they extended hospitality to all who arrived in Toronto, which was a native word meaning meeting place in the language of the Wendat people, who were the original inhabitants before a smallpox epidemic wiped them out. But at that time, the area was pronounced by the Wendats to run to. But as you know, we all natives now of Toronto often just pronounce it Toronto. Anyway, as generous host to all visitors, including the white settlers, who also saw the value of the territory and the easy access to the Great Lakes, the Mississaugas agreed to a request by the settlers for some land as a permanent settlement. So the Mississaugas surrendered a tract of land called the Toronto Purchase, and the final payment was concluded just in the year 2010. So this morning we acknowledge the gift of traditional territory of the Mississaugas and the New Credit to the people of Canada. So in accordance with our traditions, the First Nation teachings, we also honor the Mother Earth through the seven grandfather teachings: wisdom, courage, respect, honesty, truth, humility, and love. We also honor the four directions: north, south, east, and west. We honor the four elements: water, air, earth, and fire. And the four seasons: the spring, summer, the fall, and the winter. We say that the spring is for children, summer for adolescents, fall for adulthood, and the winter is the time of the elders and the time of storytelling and mentoring. In any case, this second day of summer, as an Ojibwe Potawatomi elder, I would like to offer all of you this blessing this afternoon. O my mother, the earth, O my father, the sky, your children are we, and with tired backs we bring to you the gifts that you love. Then weave for us a garment of brightness. May the weft be the white light of morning. May the warp be the red light of evening. May the border be the standing rainbow. And may the fringe be the falling rain. Then weave for us a garment of brightness, that we may fittingly walk where birds sing, that we may fittingly walk where grass is green. O my mother, the earth, O my father, the sky. And in closing, I'd like to share with you this poem that I wrote, and I hope it inspires all the young artists that are here with us today and the ones that will be coming along in the future. It's called The Power of the Land. In every nation, in every clan, the elders to a person, whether woman or a man, shared a common truth, one truth to understand, that the spirit of the people is equal to the power of the land. The mother of us all, the sacred Mother Earth, is constant in her giving and perpetual in her birth. In meadows and in fields where weeds and flowers grow, she conceives the summer showers and spawns the winter snows. In forests and in mountains, she gives the birds that fly every type of wing, then coaxes the wind to join in harmony when they begin to sing. In brooks and streams and rivers as they flow, she generates the dreams that make the fires glow. And in every creature, large and small, she buries gems of wisdom in them all. And in every grain of sand, she plants the knowledge of the power of the land. And those that honor her creations and acknowledge her grand design are given the templates of the sacred and the patterns of the divine. And then with certain knowledge, this to understand that the spirit of the people is equal to the power of the land. Megwetch.
Hello, tout le monde. Hi, good afternoon. Okay, he's gonna go. It's all you.
Yeah?
Yeah, hello. I'll join you just quietly.
How's everyone feeling today? How are you guys feeling today? How's everyone feeling today? I was tired today, so I need to do this. So I go by the name of Balu Ballistic. I've probably done community outreach probably since I was 14 years old. You name the community in around GTA Toronto, I've probably been there. And to my left, we have the lovely
Nathalie Tremblay. Salut. C'est vraiment un plaisir de vous faire connaissance. Je viens de Pointe-Roche, c'est dans le sud-ouest de l'Ontario. Et aussi, je travaille dans les arts communautaires à travers l'organisation Sketch et The People Project et avec beaucoup de jeunes LGBTQ et deux esprits. That's my story. And I don't beatbox, but I can do a really good hornless trumpet.
we gotta save that. We gotta save it. Not yet.
A sample. Okay.
So you ready to get this started?
Let's do it.
All right. So, first we want to say, does anybody have Twitter?
Tweet.
So if you have Twitter or whatever they call it, if everyone can hashtag YSP14, and then people around Toronto could be like, wow, what's happening at the YSP14? And they'll walk in and have fun with us.
C'est ça. Et en français, un tweet, c'est un gazouiller. Alors, c'est sur le hashtag YSP14. Un gazouiller, OK? Parfait.
And also we want to mention that the Youth Solidarity Forum is also kicking off JARE's Vision Dare to Stand Out 2014 Summit, and we're going to talk about that later in the show as well. Mm-hmm.
Et aussi, on veut vous faire rappeler que plus tard, la commémoration des Stonewall Riots continue après le forum aujourd'hui dans le parc Alexander Wood. C'est juste à côté de Church Street.
And also, there will be a commemoration of the Stonewall Riots at Alexander Wood's statue after the forum. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, first up. If I'm going too fast, let me know. First up, we have Matthew. And Matthew Tittlebaum, he's Michael and Sonia Kerner, director and CEO of the Art Gallery of Ontario.
Et en français. Nous voulons inviter Mathieu Teitelbaum, le directeur de Michel et Sonia Kerner, et aussi le PDG du Musée des Beaux-Arts de l'Ontario.
So please make some noise for Michael.
So I said, just make sure I don't have to follow Michaëlle Jean, because she's really good. And then they had me follow the two of you. I mean, I don't get it. Anyway, listen, people are saying thank you to the AGO for doing this. I don't really get it, because it's really thank you to the artists, to Michaëlle and Jean-Daniel, and to all of you for coming out, because when you come out for projects like this, and when you spend your time thinking about what art can do in your life, you change our community and our world. So thank you to you for making this happen. We have a saying at the AGO that the more we give away, the richer we are. And we believe that. We believe that we must be an institution connected with our community, giving our resources and our opportunity to people to find their voice. So today is a very special day for us, in which we recognize not our generosity to you, but the generosity of so many in our community, including artists from across Canada, who are making our space come alive. We are a public space, and we do come alive by virtue of how the public interacts with us. And the most important thing for us is to create an invitation to people in our community to feel that this is their home. So again, thank you for being here, and thank you for bringing the spirit of home to the Art Gallery of Ontario. I want to acknowledge that we're joined today by Sean Hillier, the co-chair of the Board of Directors of World Pride, one of our major partners on the Youth Solidarity Project. We're joined by Barbara Hall, the Chief Commissioner of Ontario Human Rights. Really glad that you're here, Barbara. And of course, we're joined by the Right Honourable Michaëlle Jean and Jean-Daniel Lafond, the co-founders of the Michaëlle Jean Foundation and the co-creators of the Youth Solidarity Project. So give me just one moment to be intimate with the artist for a moment and just say, there are two there, there are three there, I'm missing one. Okay, one, two, okay, here you are. So this is only to say to you that upstairs we have the work of Pablo Picasso, and he belongs here. And we have your work, and you belong here. And it makes us feel really good. So now, with great pleasure, it's Michaëlle Jean and Jean-Daniel Lafond to tell us a little bit about their project and to bring spirit into the room.
Is the Honorable Jean Augustine in the room? I want to say hello to her. She was supposed to come. She's not here. Okay, anyway, she's with us in spirit. I want to say hello to all of you, and also to Barbara Hall, to you, Matthew. Yes, it is also thanks to you that this is happening. We've been talking about it for less than a year, and AGO, WAM, decided that this partnership was important, so we're very excited. Sean Hillier, where are you, Sean? Sean is here. Jeremy Diaz, Jeremy's here. Cyrus, Kerry, dear friends, chers amis. Premièrement, c'est vraiment extraordinaire qu'on soit tous ici ensemble aujourd'hui et qu'on soit là pour célébrer le pouvoir des arts. Le pouvoir des arts en toutes circonstances, pour dire haut et fort ce que nous sommes, ce que nous pensons. Et à l'occasion du World Pride, c'est d'autant plus important de dire ce que nous sommes et ce que nous pensons et ce que nous voulons. So I want to thank Dr. Duke Redbird for his very moving words. I think his words, his blessing and his poetry really filled the room, and it's going to stay with us in our minds, in our hearts for the entire day and maybe even longer than that, because I think it's very important to honor the wisdom and tenacity of the First Peoples to inhabit this beautiful land, to protect it, a land that is scared also, so it's even more important to protect it. Scarred, yeah, I knew that something was wrong. Okay, so we are also in the midst of National Aboriginal Day weekend, and it is therefore only fitting that we open our Youth Solidarity Forum under the auspices of a traditional Aboriginal blessing. And again, it's important to say that Indigenous cultures are Canada's deepest and most ancient cultural root, and we as a country must always do everything in our power to preserve, cherish, and protect them for generations to come. And lest we forget how much colonialism and the Indian residential school system almost completely wiped out the rich languages, customs, and wisdom of our Indigenous forebearers. Customs which, it must be said, often embraced diversity in its fullness long before the words equality, human rights, or freedom were ever uttered. So in gathering in solidarity with Canada's two-spirited and LGBTTI and 2Q youth, boy, that is a long abbreviation, but so inclusive. The most important part of it, of all these letters put together, and what they mean is that spirit of inclusiveness. It's very important. And we are, I think, in a way, really reclaiming the wisdom and spirit of harmony that animated so many Aboriginal nations before the advent of colonialism. And what a better way to embrace that spirit than through the arts, which have such a powerful way of breaking down barriers, bringing people together, and enhancing mutual understanding. So today, we pay tribute to six very talented artists whose artwork was selected by a jury, and Jean-Daniel was part of the jury, to be featured in an exhibition housed here, right here at the Art Gallery of Ontario. And what you said, Matthew, is so right. They are here, they belong here, as well as Picasso does, right? It's huge, it's important, and especially with such a powerful message. So I want to really to thank the AGO and the KM Hunter Foundation for helping to provide these young artists with bursaries for their work. And allow me also to express my sincere gratitude to you, Matthew, and your team, Cyrus, Kerry, Joanne, and everyone else at the AGO who helped really make this wonderful dream of World Pride exhibition possible. Merci beaucoup. The Michaëlle Jean Foundation has been delighted really to work on this project closely with AGO, World Pride 2014, and of course, JURS Vision, with whom we are kicking off the Dare to Stand Out 2014 Summit. And we need a round of applause for that. And we would also like to acknowledge the direct support we received from over 55 human rights, Aboriginal, faith-based, health, arts, newcomer, and youth organizations from across the country. Organizations who deeply believed in our message of solidarity and understanding. So, thank you all for your precious collaboration. Jean-Daniel.
So, thank you, Michael. Je devrais peut-être ajouter quelques mots sur le projet, sur le forum et sur le projet même de cette exposition. Perhaps I may add that this forum and the exhibition are both part of a broader initiative the foundation kicked off last February in Montreal called The Fourth Wall, Make the Invisible Visible. Inspired by the concept in theater of fourth wall, you know, an invisible wall that separates the spectator from the audience, we decided to invite museums and art galleries across Canada to open their doors to emerging artists wishing to raise awareness about invisible issues affecting them by making visible their talents and ideas. We did this first at the Montreal Museum of Fine Arts in Montreal, where our joint exhibition coincided with Black History Month. There, we commissioned 8 very dynamic young visual artists of African descent to create artwork that reinterpreted the museum's permanent collection of Quebecois and Canadian art. It was a big success, you know. Through their own eyes and experiences, these emerging artists brought Montrealers on a creative journey to discover the specific realities and issues faced by the province's diverse Black communities. The launch was a hit, garnering major media and public attention, and igniting a public conversation on ways to better promote the rights and inclusion of Black youth within Quebec and Canadian society. Bolstered by our success, we sat down with Mathieu Tetelbaum and his team, Cyrus and Kerry, to convince them of the value and virtue of hosting a special exhibition to celebrate World Pride. Luckily, Agio immediately, as you said, seized on the idea, and the rest is a good story now, you know. Here we are today in Toronto, where people have gathered from the four corners of the planet to give a national or international platform to an exhibition that gives visibility to the often invisible realities of Canada Two-Spirited and LGBTIQ around the world. But what about rights here in Canada? Over the course of the last few years, yes. Speak up, my dear, speak up. Over the course of the last few years, my wife and I have heard directly from Canadians across the country who have told us about very real challenges existing right here at home. We know, for example, that over 70% of LGBTQ high school students report being bullied because of their perceived sexuality or gender identity. Statistics Canada reports that hate crimes based on sexual orientation are increasing and are the most violent of all crimes motivated by hate. By hate, you know, it's terrible. Various studies on mental demonstrate that LGBTQ youth are also still more likely to contemplate and even commit suicide. This is quite daunting. Yes, we can find comfort and pride
in the hundreds of organizations, like the ones represented amongst us today, who are defying the odds to make a difference. But much still remains to be done. We cannot let our hands down, nor can we be indifferent. What the young artists are telling us here on the wall through the exhibition is that all Canadians, no matter your background, faith, your persuasion, have a role to play in creating communities that are truly safe, welcoming, and inclusive for our two-spirited and LGBTQ youth. The Youth Solidarity Exhibition demonstrates that the arts have a critical role to play in that regard. By raising awareness, challenging preconceived ideas, and affirming a spirit of solidarity, artists, whether young or young at heart, have a critical role to play. By using the arts as a weapon of mass construction, you become our greatest ambassadors. Thank you. You know. Thank you a lot. Thank you. Thank you, and now I think it's step by step your turn to talk, you know. But I don't know what is the program now. Hey, it's the MC, where are you? Hey! I love your. So, it's your turn now.
Please make some noise for Jean-Daniel, please. Next up, we have Sean Hillier from World Pride Toronto 2014, also known as Pride Mondial Toronto. That's my French translation. Please make some noise.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to begin by thanking the Michaëlle Jean Foundation and the Art Gallery of Ontario for putting together what has been a truly inspiring experience for all the youth that have participated, and this is demonstrated by the artwork that we see today. It means a great deal for Pride Toronto to be involved in this project, recognizing it as one of our official World Pride events. The Pride celebrations of today have been over 40 years in the making. Pride has been built on the efforts of generations of activists, and it continues to grow today. Every generation and every community comes to Pride in a different context and with a different understanding. This project truly highlights from a youth perspective what it means to be queer. Pride should also reflect what's happening in our communities, and youth voices are an essential element in the struggle and for that celebration. I welcome the youth here today with us and congratulate you on your work. I would also like to welcome you to Toronto and to World Pride 2014. We will be welcoming the world to join us over the next 7 days for World Pride. This citywide celebration has been built on the work of many collaborative partnerships like the one we are attending here today. These partnerships not only provide almost 560 days of programming in just over a month by our major partners during the festival, but it showcases Toronto's thriving arts and cultures for the world to see. World Pride is a celebration of human rights and a chance to learn from each other. In this significant year, Pride Toronto has chosen to recognize Two Spirits Toronto as its honored group in the Pride Parade. Canada's Two Spirit and Indigenous communities continue to show real leadership in combating intolerance and discrimination. The Pride movement does this by confronting these attitudes with a celebration of who we are. That is why your voices are so important today. But we celebrate these voices not only as leaders in the struggle, but as inspired creative talents. We thank the artists for their contributions, and once again, we congratulate you on your achievements and your beautiful artwork. Thank you, Miigwech.
Thank you, Sean. Next up, we have Jeremy Diaz from Jer's Vision, Vision de Jer. Please make some noise.
Bonjour tout le monde, ça m'a fait tellement plaisir d'être ici. good afternoon, everyone. It is such an honor to be here among dear friends. I'd like to begin, actually, by thanking the inspiring artists for their hard work. Art has been a core of the organization that I get to work for every single day. Through art, we get to tell our stories, we get to share our history, we get to change the world. We inspire people to think differently, and that saves lives. My organization, our organization, Chair's Vision, will be celebrating our 10th anniversary next week. We will be celebrating 10 years of changing the way schools and youth communities run. We'll be celebrating 10 years of saving lives. I grew up in Sault Ste. Marie, like one of my dear friends, and I sued my high school because it was homophobic and because it was racist. I used the money from my human rights lawsuit. Thanks for coming, Commissioner. And 10 years ago, I sat with my friends in a dorm room at the University of Ottawa, and we thought, hey, why don't we go to schools and share our stories? And in sharing our stories and sharing our lives, we taught LGBTQ youth in schools across the country that they weren't alone. We taught straight students that homophobia and transphobia, biphobia, and oppression of all kinds was inappropriate and unacceptable. And this is critical to understand because Mr. Jean-Daniel's statistics are real. And while I don't want to belabor the point of the criticalness of the systems that we live in, LGBTQ youth are oppressed in ways that many in this room don't see and don't feel. We must remember that we have a moral obligation to be involved, to make a difference. And in the absence of my previous speakers, I will challenge myself to tell you something controversial. Less than 1% of donations to charities go to LGBTQ organizations. Volunteership is lowest among LGBTQ organizations. And while we celebrate World Pride in a thriving city, the work of Toronto Pride was not easy and a hard road to climb. Every dollar and every flag that was raised was done with blood and sweat and tears. And it is important to remember that this party celebrates 45 years of the decriminalization of homosexuality in our country. And that short time ago, it was illegal for me to stand here and share with you what I do, for you to sit and be safe. And while I say that with pride, only blocks away from here, there are schools where students sit and are not safe. So I encourage you today to volunteer your time here at the Art Gallery with the Foundation Michaëlle Jean, or with Pride Toronto, or with Jair's Vision. And in fact, I am happy to announce today that in partnership with all four school boards, here in Toronto, we are going to be hosting LGBTQ youth training forums where we show youth, both LGBTQ and straight, how to make their schools a safer and better place. Forums here in Toronto, Brampton, Hamilton, Guelph, Windsor, all across our province, all across our country. In fact, every day of the school year, Jair's Vision volunteers, some of whom sit in this audience right now, share their lives and their stories with young people. And they change the way our school systems run. They train teachers to do better. They train parents to be loving and accepting. And they change the way we learn. We also will be running over 30 training forums, 3 national events. And of course, I expect all of you to be wearing pink on the International Day of Pink, April 8th, 2015. And if you think it's too early to start planning, don't kid yourself. Because wearing a pink shirt does not stop bullying. One workshop by Jair's Vision does not stop homophobia and transphobia. This work is a lifelong, ongoing, and engaging process. It is about changing the hearts and minds, because as we stand here with almost all the legal rights, and I emphasize almost because there are people in our community who still do not stand as equal, so we need to stand with them and fight But as I stand here, it's no longer only about fighting for pieces of paper, but about changing hearts and minds. That's the work I get to do every day. That's the work I encourage you to do as well. And if you need help doing it, volunteer. And if you don't have time, give me money. Thank you.
This is, again, please make some noise again for Jared's vision. So this is one of my our favorite parts of for this afternoon. We get to talk to the project finalists. Mm-hmm. So please, first, let's all make some noise for the recipients, the project finalists that's here today.
Nous voulons accueillir chaleureusement les finalistes aujourd'hui.
So I'm just going to call them one by one, and then slowly we'll fill up the chairs. First person we're going to be calling up is Roxanne Martin.
Mathilde Saint-Mars.
Pablo Munez.
Bogdan Sali.
You know what? Just keep on clapping until we're done. Next is Leo Semilo. And last of all,
Brianne Walker.
And these are your project finalists. Please make some noise.
Okay, so we have a couple questions for each of you, yeah? So you can give a little bit more context and insight about your brilliance for the audience. And then, of course, we're going to open this up to the audience to have a bit of a like a question and answer period, okay? So when things come up, just like hold it, yeah? A passionate question, hold it, okay? Roxanne, okay. Would you be inclined to share a little bit about your relationship or your connection to the artist Cecil Young Fox, who, as we understand, has greatly influenced your work, and also to share a little bit about the importance of Two-Spirit people to Aboriginal culture, Indigenous culture, and also within the larger context of I Don't Know More, why it's so dang powerful. Yeah? Mm-hmm. It's a lot. Okay.
Wena Boju, Bejek Anun Gokwe Indigenous Cause. Migizis Indu Dem, Wakwamakwan, Port Credit, and Dunjaba, Ojibwe Anishinaabe Kwe Indau, Minoaya. My name is Roxanne Martin. My spirit name is One Star Woman. I'm from the Eagle Clan. I'm from Wakwamakwan, that's my First Nations, but I was also born pretty close here in Port Credit. Within my artwork, I wanted to do something that was related to the Idle No More movement. I have had all my friends have been politically involved into the movement, but I felt like I still needed to do something that was related towards the movement, but have some kind of artist effect onto it. My uncle, Cecil Young Fox, he's also my godfather. He passed away when he was pretty in his prime, kind of when he was in his art form. But with his visions, I've been having things of like doing just gestural movements of just everyday life. And I've really got involved into the movement of the Idle No More. I wanted to do something that I was able to express who I was as a First Nations person, but also as an artist. He's just been such a mentor to me spiritually. I have visions of like certain ideas and ways that he wants me to connect and how he wants me to go forth with his dreams and with his visions that he had. Just in general with the Two Spirit, I have a lot of friends that are also LGTB. And I find that with the Two Spirited, it's not something that we should be ashamed of. It's something that we really need to express, because within our culture, it's a blessing to have two-spirited personality gender roles, because in the community, you're able to have a female masculine woman to be able to do two roles, with labor or with being able to work within just doing female gender roles, where we figured that it's more of a religious role, and they're also teachers in our communities. And I think that because we now know more about their special gender roles within it, I think that it's more able to, that they're able to express who they are as people, and not just somebody that's just because they're not accepted into societies. But within that, I just feel that my uncle, he had a really major impact here in Toronto within the communities, and he really wanted to express who he was, because back then it wasn't something that he wanted to come out forth. But then after realizing, he met his partner Alberto De Castro here in Toronto. So when they met together, he got sober, and he was able to express who he was as a First Nations artist. And when they got together, they were able to create a lot more and express who they were. So having that vision, I just feel like he's such a wonderful man. I really wish I got to meet him more. He died about when I was about a year old. But because I'm taking on almost the same role with the fine arts, I feel like I'm able to go forth and push this. And it just shows right now today, here I am standing and being able to do the visions that he always wanted me to do. So, miigwech.
Please make some noise for Roxanne.
Merci beaucoup. OK, Mathilde, t'es prête? OK. Peux-tu expliquer un peu ton œuvre et pourquoi, selon toi, il est important d'utiliser les arts comme outil pour transformer, rassembler les gens et spécifiquement briser les barrières?
Allô? Bonjour. Hi, everyone. I would like to speak English, but I'm too nervous now, so I speak French. Oui, ben, je suis, voilà, mon dessin, j'ai essayé de faire quelque chose de très simple. En fait, j'ai essayé de voir qu'est-ce qui était... souvent, on voit la communauté LGBTQ, on en parle pour leurs différences, mais j'ai eu envie de montrer qu'est-ce qui était une similarité, finalement, entre tous ces gens-là, puis qui était finalement le cœur, puis que tout ça était seulement une question d'amour. Alors, un peu naïvement, ben, j'ai montré une foule, et puis... avec le drapeau multicolore qui se déroule et puis qui monte. Sous le drapeau, il n'y a pas le diable ou du feu, mais bien des cœurs dans chacune des personnes.
Je peux-tu faire une traduction? OK. Really simply, she was saying that she wanted to approach something that really seemed like a simple question, but is apparently complicated, ultimately rooted in love. So she was working with le drapeau, she was working with the rainbow flag, and instead of having an image of like the devil or something like this, it has hearts on it. Yeah, plus ou moins.
Merci. Oui, c'est ça. Et puis, sinon, l'art, moi je fais de l'illustration, j'essaie d'utiliser ces habiletés-là pour justement, toujours pour des causes sociales ou au moins que... C'est ça, qui change ce que j'aimerais que le futur du pays puis du monde soit. Je pense que l'art, ça a toujours été vraiment symptomatique des émotions puis de l'âme d'un pays. Juste pendant la guerre, c'est clair, c'est la première chose qui a détruit les œuvres d'art. Quand on veut toucher à une nation, on touche directement à ses œuvres d'art. Fait que je pense que c'est quelque chose de gros. De faire des concours comme ça, de faire des visibilités par les arts, parce que ça touche particulièrement les gens, et puis en espérant que ça touche quelque chose de profond, qu'on aille vers un avenir, qu'on n'ait même plus besoin d'en parler, de l'orientation, que ce soit juste la norme, puis qu'on parle seulement d'amour.
OK. That was a lot. Okay. So she was saying, so she works in illustration, and specifically that she aspires to use illustration as her art form to address issues in community that she thinks people really need to talk about. And in particular, she was saying that she really believes in art as a tool to address things that are difficult, for example, war or things that essentially you're trying to get to the heart of something and reach people's hearts through the arts rather than just talking about it. And that is something that is really profound, and it reaches the spirit through the arts, and that's what she's trying to do with her work. Plus ou moins? More or less.
Oui, puis je suis vraiment contente d'être ici. J'ai une petite fille, et puis c'est vraiment, comme je disais tout à l'heure, des événements comme ça qui me font croire vraiment qu'un futur de mieux en mieux, quelque chose de beau s'en vient pour elle, puis pour tout le monde.
And she was saying she's really, really thankful to be here. She's here with her daughter, and that these events are really, really important and transformative.
Please make some noise for the daughter. Next up, we got Pablo. How are you doing, Pablo?
Doing all right.
I know you're trying to focus on the mic, and then you have the baby next to you. So, we're wondering, Pablo, if you can explain some of the artwork that you've done, because you've touched, I guess you've addressed an important issue of the migrant and racialized LGBTQ youth in Canada. So maybe you can talk a little bit about your artwork and how it all interplays together.
Yes.
And this is his work.
So I'll say a little bit about myself first. My name is Pablo Munoz, and I'm originally from Colombia. I live in Vancouver. And I came here as a refugee, and I work with immigrant and refugee young people. And I felt like I needed to speak to that, to my community. and the particular issues that the migrant and refugee and POC, people of color community faces. At any given time, I'm aware of one queer refugee who is being held in a detention center in Vancouver, who came here escaping violence and encountered different forms of violence when they arrived. Usually, when the community comes together, we're able to get these refugees out of prisons and try to get them resources. But the trauma that is left after being in prison is awful. And I don't understand, you know, why is this happening? I feel like, actually, I know that Canada is a nation with a lot of compassion and with a lot of love. The same place that opened up the doors for me to come here. But I feel like the current policies are not reflecting that. And we are further marginalizing queer, trans people by putting them into detention centers, by denying the protection that we can't provide and that we have the resources to provide. So I wanted to speak particularly about that, and that's where this kind of piece came from.
Thank you for sharing, Pablo. Yes. Next up, we have Bogdan. How are you?
Hi, guys.
Good.
Can I use
And before I begin, I just want to say on behalf of both of us, thank you so much for sharing your perspectives and your sides, because it's not easy to talk about out loud, especially in front of public. So thank you again for everyone for sharing. So Bogdan, you want to talk?
Oh, sure. Would you want to talk about a little bit why openly gay athletes in the sports world is so important? What? There are openly gay people in the sports world?
I'm joking. You imagine?
Of course they are. I played hockey. They're all over. Excuse me. And why it's so important, and in particular why you chose to emphasize that reality in your piece, and also maybe talk a little bit about your experience in general, and why you put that in your art.
First of all, I'm really glad to be here among all of you guys, friends, I guess, and it's a great pleasure to send the message that we can direct to young people and kind of educate them. Was mentioned before, it's great that this such kind of job is done with younger population, and now I'll just talk about my piece of the job and gays in professional sports, right? So I came from Ukraine, and for those who don't know where is Ukraine, it's Europe, and we have really, really traditional society back there. And from the very beginning, when I spent some time here in Toronto, I was amazed how the society is tolerant to those people who are different in terms of religion, in terms of their sexual orientation, and skin color and whatsoever. So I was really, really inspired by that, by the fact that people can understand and respect those differences, right? However, I also find an article in Times Magazine where Jason Collison, he's actually was a role model for my picture, right? And I found that article when he was speaking about gays in professional sports and how people still treat gays in professional sports like something wrong or something that cannot be there in the sports, right? And people make that separation, like gays and not gays, and still seeing given some roles for those people, right? You cannot do sports if you're gay. You cannot do like a man job if you're gay, right? You can do that, you can do this, but you cannot do something else, right? And I was kind of shocked by that. And in my picture, I tried to kind of emphasize that effect and emphasize that there is nothing to shame about, right? If you're gay, there is nothing to shame about. And you cannot live happily with yourself if you cannot say the truth, if you always live in the lie. And that's kind of that kind of message that I try to send to the public, that tell the truth. Be whoever you are, and be truly open to yourself, and that way you can reach the happiness in this life, because I believe all people come to this earth to be happy and spend great time, and if you live with lie inside, it makes you hurt, right? So basically that's what I try to illustrate and emphasize in my art.
Thank you, Bogdan.
Merci beaucoup.
I'm listening to you, and I was like, I gotta be more happier. So thank you for that.
You're pretty happy.
Thank you. So next up, we got Leo. We were talking in the back. He's very loud and he's very extroverted.
Boisterous.
So I told him to calm down. I'm just joking. He's really nervous. So thank you for respecting. This next gentleman, we have Leo. So as artists, we all face our own serious obstacles and stress points and whatnot. But how do you, in particular, take that and throw it into a more of a celebration of life and pride?
Well, first off, I'm from Surrey, BC, which is like a small town near Vancouver, which you don't want to go to. Because
can everyone hear him in the back?
Yeah. Sorry about
if
that.
You could just speak up, or maybe the volume in the side can go. Try again.
Okay, so I'm from a city called Surrey, BC. It's town near Vancouver that you don't want to go to because it's really violent. But what is it now? Wait, what's the question?
And the question is, how do you take all your stress and your obstacles or everyday situations that you deal with and take it in and put it into a more of a celebration of who you are and your pride through your artwork?
Okay, well, the piece was like kind of inspired by the movie Mean Girls, you know, near the end where like Katie's taking apart the tiara and giving it to people. Like, I don't know what to say. Basically celebrate who you are, and like don't be like, be proud of who you are and just like celebrate
be
sexuality.
And I'm gonna not make you continue more, so please make some noise for Leo. Thank you, you did a great job.
Merci beaucoup. Okay, and last but not least, Brienne.
Hey.
Okay, so I'd love to invite you to tell a little bit about your uncle. So, as I understand, your uncle had misgivings about LGBTQ people. You're like, oh.
No.
No? Different?
Yes.
Okay. Well, so then that's what I have in my notes, but the notes are faulty. And so we'll just go on with, tell us about your experience and how that communicates the power of the arts.
Okay. Well, my experience has been like, how can I explain this? Well, like with the LGBTIQQ and two-spirited communities, there's a lot of different aspects that are involved and they all can come together. So that's really what I tried to show in my artwork, is that there's all these different pieces and that's displayed in the different colors, along with the pride flag in the background, tying it all together. And my experience has been pretty good. You know, I've gotten to meet a lot of people and I've gotten a lot of positive comments on my art, so that's been pretty amazing. And that my art has been able to impact people in many different ways, so that's been pretty awesome. Yeah.
Cool.
Thank you, Brianne. Please make some noise for Brianne.
Okay. Et là, on va continuer un peu. On va ouvrir la discussion. We're going to continue a little bit. We're going to open up the discussion to the audience. So hopefully you've been scintillated and titillated by these little insights y'all gave. And we're going to ask some questions that kind of go to everyone, yeah? On va poser des questions, trois questions très spécifiques, okay?
Is everyone still with us? All right? Okay. Just checking.
Okay.
So the first question, hopefully we have some VIPs in the house, so... We'll pick and choose, you know, who's going to get the questions.
If it's dead, if there's perfect silence, then we'll call on the VIPs. But otherwise, we'll call on them afterwards. You might not know that you are one of the VIPs. Think of a good question.
Okay. So the first question, what are some of the challenges LGBTQ and two-spirited youth face in Canada today?
Pretty big, open-ended. Quelles sont quelques-unes de les barrières que les jeunes LGBTQ et deux esprits experience in Canada.
So we got one person. So how do we have a mic to go into the crowd, or can they? Oh, maybe.
Yeah.
Here it comes. Go for it.
Beautiful. I'm coming.
Okay, Matt. You're good where you are.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Julian, and I am genderqueer identified. My pronoun is gender neutral, so it's they. I think that to answer that question, I think that the biggest challenge is no spaces for recreation, especially when there are organizations that say that they have a welcoming policy and everybody is included. But when you ask about if it's written down in policy, to make sure that nobody comes to us with hatred or any bad words to discriminate our identities, then the answer to that is we don't focus specifically on LGBTQ issues. This organization does not focus on that. And that is extremely aggravating. It's sad and it's disruptive. Within the queer community, there's a lot of spaces that assume a welcoming policy, but the policy is not written down, and there's no specificities. So how is it safe if the policy is not written down? How can somebody avoid an issue of bullying or crime or rape or kidnap or death against a queer person? How do you avoid that? Through policy. So I think that's the biggest challenge, to be honest.
Okay. D'autres réponses? Any other responses? No? Okay. Maybe now is a great time to call on one of our VIPs. Yeah? Go for it.
So the first VIP that we're going to be calling up is the Honorable Jean Augustine.
No, not here?
No.
Not the spirit of the Honorable Jean Augustine.
Okay. All right, next VIP we're going to. we have, and this VIP, I remember when I was like 12 seeing her on stage, and I'm very honored to call her up. We have the Honorable Julie Black, who is the Juno Award-winning RNN soul singer and TV personality. Please make some noise for Julie Black.
Yeah. In particular, we're really interested in hearing from you why you believe the arts, and in particular music, is such a powerful tool to bring people together and build understanding between different peoples.
Hey. Yes. Me. How's everybody doing? Are you feeling good? Are you feeling really good? Maybe I should get this microphone turned up a little bit, or we could do it church style, and I don't even need it. It's Sunday, right? We could just have church up in here. Where's my sound? Who's rocking this microphone? Yeah? Oh. Yeah? Yeah. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Excited to be here. Extremely excited to be here. Look how fast you... Super excited to be here. Music, the universal language. You know, music is basically one of those things that you don't have to speak English. You don't even have to share the same religion. You don't have to be of the same culture. We speak music. And music to me is love, right? And so being asked to come and speak and represent the youth of the LGBTQ community was super, super honorable. The reality is we are all humans, period. Are you gay? Are you straight? Are you lesbian? Are you queer? Are you transgendered? We are all human. We were all created by the same source, whatever source you feel that is. We were all created. I know I didn't create me, even though sometimes I feel that way. But we are all human. And so for me, growing up, especially in Canada, being able to look around, even in this room, and see that we are like the United Colors of Benetton ad right here. If we were all turn around and someone took a picture of us, we could make some money off that picture. Right? Because we are more alike than we are different. Ask me if, you know, if we don't share some of the same things as women, men, but as people. And so being able to be a storyteller, songwriter, what really, really, really got me going into this, being able to represent being a citizen of the world, doesn't just give you a 5-minute story, is my mother. What happened to me? Woo! I just noticed you down there. Yes! Yes! But long story short, my mom came here in the 60s. She worked for $1.65 an hour. She raised 9 children on her own. And she came to Canada and had me, the foreign baby, they call me, my siblings. You're the foreign baby. I'm the poil, as poil according to Jamaicans, but I'm the spoiled one. But to know that my mom came here and really, you know, if it weren't for, she says, you know, I really wanted you to marry Justin Trudeau, you know, because if it wasn't for his father, you wouldn't be here. You guys would have had some cute picnic, you know.
He's just disappearing.
Right? But I digress. The reality is this. Mom made a sacrifice, and she was courageous. She came here, and just like there's a struggle with the whole LGBTQ community, I look at my mom's plight with no education, coming here being labeled, working in the factory, etc. You know, she was courageous. Just a couple days ago, when I was having my own frustrating moment of what's going on with the music industry and blah, 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 randomly, the power of the universe, mom said, you know what, I have to tell you this. This is a part of the story you didn't know. When I got the call, I got a telegram to come to Canada from my friend Fitzy. Fitzy, right, of all names. I was on the bus, and the bus turned over in a gully on the way to the airport. And she said, Julie, I got out that bus and I dust off. And I got on the next bus. I just made sure I found my bag because Canada had to happen. Right? All of these years later, I've told the story. She says, I'm so scandalous. I told her, I tell her age, she's 78. There's 9 kids, my sister's 56, I'm 26. I'm like, Mom, you're well, honey. Why were you still having sex 20 years later? But ultimately, there wouldn't have been a Julie, right? And there wouldn't have been this voice, not just the voice speaking to you guys, but the musical voice. Like, most of you guys know me because I'm a singer. I'm a songwriter. But ultimately, there was a plan bigger than me, bigger than us, to come together and be one voice, one heart, one community, one nation, right? So I'm not going to take up all your time, but I do want to do one thing in solidarity, if you don't mind, if you would join me. And I'm going to, in my 5-inch heels, I'm just going to stamp, and I want you to clap. Before we go, when you're feeling a little down and out, I want you to sing this and chant this in your head, in the morning, at night, in the evening, right? And it goes like this. 1, 2, 3, it goes. I am powerful. I am wonderful. I am powerful. I'm free. I'm free. Like you mean it. Come on. I am powerful. Come on. I am wonderful. Come on. I am powerful. I'm free. I'm free. Before I go, I want you to know. I sing because I'm happy, right? And I sing because I'm free. His eye is on the sparrow. And I know he watches you and me. I love y'all so much. Thank you.
And stay there specifically. We are staying with you. Oh, not very. Two kids are. Yes. Maddie, on the ball.
Julie just gave me a hug.
So the second question is a segue from the first question. So I'm just assuming that y'all were feeling really shy, and hopefully Julie just inspired you, you know, just let it out. Because the first question was, what are some of the challenges that LGBTQ and Two-Spirit youth face in Canada? And there are many. I want to appreciate that some of the speakers who opened up touched on some of these. So the second question is building on that. How are those issues being addressed through the arts?
I would like to repeat that question again because I think it's a very powerful question. How are these issues being addressed through the arts? Please calm down. Too many hands up.
Yes. Hands.
Yep.
Boom.
Yes, yes, yes.
Right. Ready, two, take two.
I think, well, maybe I'm just going to talk. Addressed through the arts by having events such as these, and also really great role models who are doing work consistently and openly in their identities. And I think that's also important because people are able to see a reflection of themselves. And even for people who are not at a place where they feel they can openly or comfortably sit in their gender identity or their sexuality, they can still participate and come. Like, there may be people here who identify in whatever part of the gender spectrum or alphabet soup, as they call it sometimes, but just may be in here and hear something through these different artists, or hear something through work that there's some artists I see here are people who do different community work, and will just come to their events or come to support what they're doing just so they can be a part of something that reflects a little bit of their identity. Because I also think it's important to recognize that there are a lot of different reasons why people don't say or identify openly as LGBTQ. Also, I want to put the I in there. There's a whole bunch of different ones. I don't remember all now. But for whatever, whether it's culture or religion or their family or fear, and that's real until or if they are able to work through that. But just being able to come and participate and just sit here now without having to identify openly, those spaces are also important. The people who do that work are also important in just existing and just openly being themselves. So yeah, the end.
Uh-huh.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Xavier. I'm from the Caribbean. Small island, might not even see it on a map. It's called St. Kitts. And the question is, how is this being transcripted through art? And first of all, I just want to say, what is art, right? Art is a way that you express yourself. So you as a LGBT person, or even an ally, the way that you express yourself in society, whether it be on paper, spoken words, or even a performance base, or even dressing yourself, because I felt like dressing myself today was a piece of art, right? So it's just the way that you express yourself, basically. So that's your one moment to teach society. I am expressing my inner queerness to show you what my art is. And my shy friend up there who said that he used, what's the movie called again? The Pat with the Tiara? Mean Girls. One of my favorite movies of all times. On Wednesday, we wear pink, right? When he said that he took that tiara inspiration and took that screen and when he broke it into pieces and showed everybody that we all can be prom queen or king, we all can be that person. That's art right there. That's the way that you display your art. He might not be the best in terms of public speaking, but I'm sure his art his art piece is the best piece that you will ever see, because he used a true moment. That movie has nothing to do with the LGBT rights or anything like that, but he used that movie still because he felt inspired. So that's what art is, and that's your moment to teach what's going on with art.
Il y a une question là-bas. There's a question over here. In the meantime, I want to plant a seed in your minds, if we can, when we wrap up this question. Can we just do like a roll call, a shout out? Because I appreciated your comments about, like, there are tons of people in our community, grassroots artists, that are doing amazing work with LGBT youth and within the LGBT community. Maybe we could just like a poem, just like call their names out just for like a minute at the end. So think on at least one fierce LGBT artist, organizer that you know that we can just invoke, if you will, just celebrate them by calling out their name. Yeah? Plus tard. Oh, go on.
Hello, my name is Maurice Tomlinson, and I'm from Jamaica. And since this is World Pride, I just want to give you an idea as to what's happening to LGBT youth around the world. And so you can bear that in mind when you think about where Canadian youth are and what advances they have or have not made. I work with a group called Duane's House, and I'd encourage you to take a postcard today and just read about what's happening to LGBT youth in Jamaica. These kids are being kicked out as young as 10 years old because of their gender expression, not necessarily their orientation, but gender expression. And they have been forced to live in abandoned buildings. These buildings are torn down, and the police evict them, and they are now living in sewers. And these kids are selling sex to survive, and they're paid extra for condomless sex by their usually married partners or clans. The last time we tested a bunch of these kids, 90% of them are HIV positive. We've been begging the government of Jamaica, just give us an empty building. We'll fundraise to outfit it, etc. So I just ask you in your consciousness to remember that you have a great gift. You've advanced tremendously here in Canada, but there are places in the world, and Jamaica is not the worst. This is by no means the worst, but this is happening to other LGBT youth around the world. So be happy about what you have and try to find a way to share it with the rest of the world. Thank you, Madame Michaëlle Jean, for your tremendous work. As a Caribbean person, I'm incredibly proud. Thank you.
So we got one more, and then we're going to go to the next speaker.
I'm sorry, I have to speak up on that one. I'm a reporter here in Toronto, and I'm non-mainstream, so I talk to a lot of people. Yesterday, I was talking to a group of youth about the issues that are here in Toronto. What you just mentioned about Jamaica, it's Toronto. It's the world. We think we have World Pride in Toronto, so we're doing great. Our men are doing wonderfully. Our lesbians and our youth are suffering every single day. We have policies in schools. Wonderful. Get them to work. Just because you have a policy does not mean that the policy goes through. We need to get the allies
to start speaking up. Every time you see someone being bullied, shout, scream. Every time you hear a mother or a father say, I cannot love my child because he loves someone who is wrong, ask them how the heck they diaper that baby's butt. Because if you can't love a child, you can't diaper their butt. Start loving, and we might actually have a change.
Thank you.
So, can we try this just like 30 seconds, just popcorn styles, shouting out at least one person's name, who, and that doesn't have to be their legal name, obviously, or how they're known in the community, who is doing artwork that is political or is radical or is fierce about the LGBT experience, and or who are organizing safer spaces for the LGBT community. Yeah? Like Cyrus Ware. Yes. Yes. To be young.
Okay, so what we're gonna do, so everyone can hear these names, because I only heard two out of those 10 names. You're gonna put your hand up nice and high. I'm gonna point at you, and you're just gonna say the name. Ready? Starting, go.
On the screen? That's that one. Oh, Zoe?
Scratching.
You've lost your screen.
Yes. You!
Anyone? I'm already on one.
Yeah.
So what's going on? Two.
Going once.
Three, two. Three, two.
Going twice. Pardon me? Pardon me?
31, two.
Going like, beside the wall? Who's beside the wall? Oh, yeah?
Yes.
I can't hear you if you don't use the microphone.
Yes.
I love how everyone's so proud to say these names out loud. Okay. Anybody else?
Thank you.
Hey.
And everyone here.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Thanks, everybody. Okay, we're segueing again into the next question. Everybody ready? Take a deep breath. The next question is, what can you and the participants here do to help show solidarity and empower LGBTQ and two-spirited youth to be included, to feel safer, and to reach their highest potential? What can you and the participants do? Yeah, can you give an example for folks who are like, what?
I wish I could retweet that right now. Please, can you say that one more time?
There you go, nice.
I'm a she, I'm not, I'm a Z. Oh. Nice. Which means ask people. Oh, self-determination, I love that. Can I ask you, what's your preferred pronoun?
My preferred pronoun is beautiful.
Now I know. Yes. Okay, anybody else? Thanks for that.
Yep.
What can you do?
Hi everyone, my name is Dominique Grant, and it's beautiful to be here. I think one of the amazing things that we can do is we can start looking at the idea of mentorship and becoming mentors ourselves. I grew up as a singer-songwriter and a theater artist, and people like Dibby Young, for example, who you know you get to train with and teach you the foundation of mentorship and of not seeing the LGBTQ community as something separate, but instead integrating it into our work and integrating it into our ability to be storytellers, and being able to go into communities, and regardless of, you know, if you work in the LGBTQ community or not, being able to say that you're a mentor and you're an ambassador of the people that are from these different communities, because we're really not different. We all share our own struggles, but being able to share that, whether you're an artist, you're an athlete, just being able to say that you're an ambassador and that you're a mentor, I think that's one of the keys to pushing this forward, and not just thinking of education, but thinking of the mentality that we have. And, you know, I go to schools where it's a course on the LGBTQ community. Why is it a simple course? Like, why are things addressed that way? It should be, it's our mentality that we need to reshape, and we need to go into communities with that perspective and not just see it as something separate.
Thank you, Dominique.
I'm gonna jump in here. We're going to tap in a VIP. J'aimerais inviter Denis Cormier et Daniel Chénier de la Fondation Émergence de nous expliquer un peu le projet Transgéria et expliquer un peu pourquoi l'art est important comme outil pour démystifier les expériences et les réalités transgenres.
Alors, bonjour tout le monde. On a 2 minutes simplement pour faire ça. Je vais le faire en français. Quelqu'un peut me traduire? Oui, on va me traduire en anglais ici. Alors, j'ai vu l'exposition Transégéria à Paris à l'été 2011. Et avec la Fondation Émergence, on a décidé de la faire venir à Montréal à l'été 2012. Mais comme nous n'avions pas de personnes trans à la Fondation Émergence, on s'est adjoint Daniel Chénier de l'ATQ, l'Aide aux Trans du Québec. Elle était présidente du CA à ce moment-là et elle a agi comme commissaire pour la version québécoise qui n'est pas tout à fait la même que la version parisienne.
I'm going to try. Thank you. I'm going to try and translate. Denis Cormier is representing Fondation Émergence, which is an organization based in Montreal that's advocating in favor of LGBTQ rights across Canada and internationally. So they decided that they wanted to do a special project focusing on trans realities and experiences. And since there was no trans person at the foundation at that moment, they decided to approach this woman, who's part of a committee working on trans issues in Montreal to provide support, I guess, and advice on the project.
Nous avons changé la moitié des œuvres parce que à Paris, c'est un peu plus choquant. Et notre mission au Québec, c'était de changer la mentalité sur la transsexualité.
So they changed, because the project was originally developed in Paris, they decided to change some of the artwork, half of the artwork, to be more reflective of the realities in Quebec and Canada.
And to change the mentalities, to give positive vibes.
And to change, the perspectives and perceptions of transgendered people to create a more positive outlook.
Nous avons fait le tour du Québec en moins d'un an.
So they went around Quebec. They toured Quebec in less than 1 year.
Et il y a eu au moins 25 000 personnes qui ont vu l'exposition directement.
And there were over 20,000 people that saw the exhibition directly.
Et c'est dans les villes les plus éloignées qu'on a vu ça a été le plus positif.
So it was in the more, I guess, further rural communities that they had the most positive reaction.
Moi, j'ajouterais que le PowerPoint était fait pour le Jackman Hall.
So the PowerPoint was created for Jackman Hall.
So on n'a pas du tout l'écran pour le PowerPoint.
So we don't have the screen for the PowerPoint.
It's too small. So peut-être qu'après la présentation, on pourrait répondre à des questions pour une ou deux des personnes trans si vous voulez avoir plus d'informations, parce que là, vous ne serez pas capable de lire le texte.
So even though the screen's smaller, so you will not necessarily be able to read the text, they're more than happy to speak with you if you have any questions after about the presentation.
We could say, vous font dire rapidement après chaque personne qui passe le nom et qu'est-ce qu'elle fait.
So they'll be able to say the name of the person that you'll see on the screen and what they do. Okay. Thank you.
Merci.
And before we continue to the next question, we're going to have another input into the discussion.
Thank you. My name is DJ. I've come here too aware of the violence done against trans feminine people all around the world in our country and here. I have been looking really hard to see if I could find trans feminine people here among the artists and images in the art. I suspect that one of the reasons why we don't see images, we don't see trans feminine people, is because the most violence is done against trans feminine people. And the answer to the question, what can people here do? What you say you're doing about every other member of the LGBTQ community? I don't see it being hard. I don't see it being difficult. It's just that being a trans feminine person apparently is the utmost in shame and degrading. Otherwise, where are we? Where are our images? Where's our artwork?
And we're going to have this one last person before we go to the next question.
So I'm going to agree with my fellow here. I am a drag queen performer, and I was born female, and I identify as trans feminine. I've been an inspiring actor for over a year, and yes, when I do get to an agency and expose my work, they are absolutely delighted until I tell them I am not your feminine straight person. And immediately they say, you have to fall into a box, otherwise you're not going to make it in this industry. Immediately I get called out as a gender bender, and the Hollywood business does not like that. TV does not like that. The newscast doesn't like that. So you better behave and accept feminine roles. And so sometimes we do fall under this confusing anger state of mind where you have to deviate from your artwork because there's no space for it in the world. Again, in order for me to be solidarian with you and tell you that we do exist, trans feminine people do exist, but we don't have the space, is the lack of space. And when there is a space and there is a policy, the people don't respect the policy. And that only makes us not know where to go. It makes us feel hopeless. And so sometimes we have to go back into the labor market where you have to work for Shoppers Drug Mart, Dixon Hall, Starbucks, and get fired because you're trans feminine. I've lost my job twice in a row. And I have to go back now into my art form to find a job. So yes, consistently we have to go in spaces and navigate to find a place where we can find work. And it gets worse when disability comes in, class comes in, caregiving status comes in, motherhood comes in, fatherhood comes in. There is a huge gap, and nobody wants to focus on it. So it's really hard to answer that question, because we try. We do try, but we have to deviate from our art to try and go back to it again to try. There's no more trying. We've done our job. It's society that doesn't do it for us and helps us come in and be included as human beings. Thank you.
Okay, so we're gonna tap in one more VIP, and then we're gonna try and explore this question through the arts, not just in conversation. But I'd like to invite Douglas Goss, general editor of the LGBTIQQ2SA Stories of Pride, Courage and Social Justice in Canada. This is a book created in partnership with EGAL Canada Human Rights Trust, highlighting the stories of LGBTQ Canadians. Please, I invite you to speak about the book and explain why storytelling is so important.
Make some noise for Douglas.
Bon, je vais dire quelques mots en français d'abord. Je suis tellement content d'être ici, de faire de nouveaux collègues. Je suis content de faire la connaissance de Madame Michaëlle Jean et de Monsieur Lafond. Et de voir des gens qui ont pris tellement d'efforts à créer ces nouveaux chefs-d'œuvre. The book that I'm general editor of is called Out Proud, Stories of Pride, Courage, and Social Justice. As an educator for 25 years, a school teacher, and now a university professor, I've been inspired by what I call a pedagogy of love. And a foundation of a pedagogy of love is social justice. So with Rebecca Rose, who's the CEO of Breakwater Publishing, the publishing house for this particular book, we brainstormed several years ago an idea. And finally, after 4 or 5 years, we see this idea come to life. However, unfortunately, I do not have the book with me. I do! It's coming, it's en route. Oh, thank you, thank you. First time I get to hold it myself, too. So, the youngest contributor to this anthology is just a mere 17 from Montreal. The eldest is in his 80s and from downtown Toronto. So it's about the voice of these participants. And I wanted to highlight, along with Rebecca, that we are not, I'll try the acronym, we are not but lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgendered, transsexual, queer, questioning, intersex, allies, two-spirited, and the list goes on. We actually had a lot of debate around these letters and how to be inclusive, because that was one of our goals. But really, it's about voice. And I noticed this in the works of art that you've created as well. Often there's a focus on the face, there's a focus on the mouth, and lo and behold, here we have lips that are in a rainbow color as well. So I encourage you to have a look at these. One of the other premises that we really wanted to embrace was looking beyond the terminology of LGBTQ and looking at how we can be queer and a person of color and working class or upper class, etc. You get my drift, what I'm talking about there. It's extremely important that we look not only at sexual orientation, but how that intersects or interplays with our race, class, gender, disability, language, and culture. Thank you.
Thank you, Douglas. So next up, we have a performance. I've heard of this organization throughout Toronto. I'm very happy to invite four youth to represent the organization called Sketch. So please make some noise for Sketch. Thank you.
Hi, we are C2Y and Acting Out, and we believe that youth who have experience in the social service sector have a lot to teach those who work in the social service sector. So yeah, that's what we do.
We provide a drama-based educational experience for people who work with and care about youth and children.
Katie. We create our characters and scenarios out of our own experiences. None of us play our own stories.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Shaka. I'm 15 years old and I'm bisexual. My parents told me I'm going to hell. I came up to my friends who are gay, expecting them to kind of be like accepting, but they told me that I should stop sitting on the fence and come all the way out. So I ended up talking to a youth worker, and they told me, because of my culture, I can't be bisexual. I can't be who I am. I don't know what to do. I don't know how to feel. Am I really going to hell?
Hi, I'm Joe. I'm 7 and a half, but I'm gonna be 8 in 2 weeks. I love Pokemon. Gotta catch them all. Pokemon. Some people came to my house the other day, and they took me away from my mommy because sometimes she gets really angry. I wish she didn't get so angry. I don't really understand why I have to go and live with those people over there in that house. I just don't understand it. I wish he didn't get very angry. Maybe when she finishes her classes, so she's not so angry anymore, maybe I can go home.
My friends call me Barbie. I'm 17 years old, and I live on my own with a friend. It's hard working and going to school. So I guess we get a little bit loud sometimes. We've been quieter since the complaints. Except the other night, my roommate had a few friends over, and I guess things got a little bit out of hand. So the next day, I go back to my apartment, and then there's this note on the door. It says, "Dear good-for-nothing teenager, teenagers, you are evicted." So I had to call my housing worker. You know, sometimes it seems like the things that our workers say to us, it's more about their wants and their needs, not ours.
You can be gay, but you don't have to be like that gay.
What do you mean that gay?
You can be gay. You just like don't have to be that gay.
I can be as gay as I want to be.
You can be gay. Just you don't have to be that gay.
That's pretty ignorant.
You have so much potential.
Thanks.
You have so much potential.
Why does your face look like that when you say that?
You have so much potential.
Sure.
You need to get a job.
I'm working on my resume.
No, you need to get a job.
Wanna edit it for me?
You need to get a job.
Want to help me find one?
You're so articulate.
Thanks.
You're so articulate.
Thank you.
You're so articulate.
Leave me alone.
You can be gay, but you don't have to be that gay.
You're so articulate.
You really need to get a job.
I'm trying.
You can be gay, but you do not have to be that gay.
You're so
articulate. Get a job.
I'm working on it.
Everybody leave me alone!
When you say I need to get a job, I feel pressured and overwhelmed with my life.
When you say you have so much potential, I feel really stupid and like a disappointment.
When you say you can be gay, but you don't have to be that gay, I feel ashamed and kind of worthless.
When you say I'm so articulate, I feel embarrassed, hurt, and then furious. I would prefer if you noticed and thought about what I did well, didn't make assumptions about me, and stopped unintentionally perpetuating racism.
When I'm around you, your energy lifts me up.
That poem you wrote was so beautiful.
Everything about you, I accept and love.
And you're so amazing at advocating for yourself.
When you told me that that poem that I wrote was written really well, I felt proud and encouraged to write more. Thank you. When you told me
that my energy lifts you up, I felt acknowledged and appreciated. Thank you.
So yeah, we are C2I and Acting Out, and we're a group of 10 trainers and 3 facilitators, as well as a lawyer. And yeah, my name is Nico Young, and I'm a trainer.
My name's Kinshasa Philpotts, and I'm a trainer.
And my name is Jasmine Alley, and I'm a facilitator. So if any of you call yourself a young person and are interested in being a trainer, find one of us, come talk to one of us. We would love to have you. We're hosting auditions in a couple months. Or if any of you work with LGBTQ young people and know some people who might be interested in this, as well as if you want to see some more of our workshops, because we offer workshops, and this is just a tiny, tiny little bit of what we do, come and find one of us, and we'll give you some more information, and we'll keep in touch. Thank you.
Yes. On the subject of issues affecting LGBT youth in Canada, LGBTQ youth are still the highest number of youth affected by homelessness, specifically two-spirit and trans-feminine youth, and also the highest number of youth in the shelter system. Noted that we don't actually have LGBT-specific or even LGBT-safe shelters in the City of Toronto. So if you're trans-feminine, you will likely be put in a shelter with other male youth and or not necessarily be protected when you experience ongoing harassment. So that is definitely an issue that we can get behind right now.
Again, please make some noise for Sketch.
Yeah. Okay. We're going to tap in one more VIP. Can I please invite the Honourable Barbara Hall, Chief Commissioner of the Ontario Human Rights Commission? And I'd like to invite you to explain why human rights, particularly the Ontario Human Rights Code, is such an important instrument for LGBTQ and two-spirited youth in Ontario to address the challenges that they face.
Barbara, please. Barbara. Make some noise for Barbara.
Hello, everyone. Pleased to be here with Diane Carter from the Human Rights Commission. Well, the Human Rights Code is a law that sets out protection for many people in our community. There are 7 grounds in the community that provide protection against discrimination and barriers. For the question was LGBTQI 2A, I think I 2SA, two-spirited, and A, allies like me and others here today. The code is a law that says it's illegal in Ontario to discriminate at work, in housing, or in receipt of services on the basis of sexual orientation and gender identity or gender expression. That law and the protection came about because people in the community advocated, they educated, they marched, they demanded, and the code over the years provides protection. The most recent amendment to the code was 2 years ago in June 2012 when gender identity and gender expression was added. So that's a law. It says you can't discriminate, but laws are just that, words on paper, until or unless people, one, are aware of their existence, aware so they know they have rights and are empowered to advance their rights, and until others are aware that they have responsibilities and obligations. So our job at the Commission was over the years to support the community and to advocate for the changes, but now that we have the law, our job is to educate people across Ontario that they have rights and they have obligations. Our job is also to do training, the kind of training we saw the artists from Sketch do, to go to schools, to go to workplaces, to go to the police, to go all across the province and give people the training and support they need to put the policies and practices into place and to learn what their obligations are. But that isn't enough. Having the law, educating and training isn't enough, because we know there are people out there who ignore the law, who don't accept it. And so in those cases, our job is to use our enforcement powers. It's to intervene in complaints. It's to go to the courts, to go to the tribunal, to hold public inquiries, to put people out there showing how they ignore the law and how they continue to discriminate and to put up barriers. So because of your activism and the activism of all the people we heard about since Stonewall, who came out, who went to the streets, who demanded rights, we have that law. But we can't take laws as the end, as guaranteeing anything. We all need to be eternally vigilant. We need to stand up, as people have said, when we see things in our school or in our workplace, we need to speak out. And the commission is one part of the allies, the resources or tools in Ontario that can get us to the point that young people can come forward and speak their rights. They can say, you can't do that to me. That's against the law. The person who was evicted, the person who's denied the job, the person who's fired or denied medical care or unsafe at school, you can use this law, the Ontario Human Rights Code, and demand your rights and demand accountability. And the commission is there as a support, as a resource to help you do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Barbara.
I wanna kind of highlight what was said from various actually participants about using the arts to build a culture, not of tolerance, not even just of acceptance, but of celebration of diversity, not just in Toronto, but also in the rural parts of Canada, one that definitely welcomes, celebrates, and supports equity, all that good stuff, right? So let's get one more group of performers up here to really embody that, the way that the arts can build a culture of celebration and equity.
So we have a second performance! This young lady, probably one of the most profound, inspirational spoken word artists that I have came across, and there's a bunch of them that represent Canada. She also represents Canada. She goes by the name of Lee Shai Peel. She represents an organization called Unity Charity. Everyone, please make some noise for Lee Shai.
Hi, everyone. Good afternoon. Happy Sunday. Happy summer solstice. Happy Pride, everyone. When I every Pride, I think about certain individuals, and this year I'm thinking about my grandmother a lot. She's, she's across the ocean, but she's an older Indian woman, very superstitious, used to believe in the heteronormative institution of marriage, and when all her grandchildren started coming out of the closet, she went from being distraught, to being kind of confused, to being supportive, and now every time she comes to visit, she wears this little pin that says homophobia sucks and not in a good way. So, I'm thinking about her a lot and sending her love. So happy Pride, everyone. I want to share a poem with you all that is inspired by a lot of people that I've encountered over the last few years. I went to school for business and international development, and when I graduated, I just didn't think that art was a viable option for me, because a lot of us who grew up with immigrant mothers, we want to be able to make enough money that we can support our families, right? So for me, art was kind of like a side thing that I was passionate about, but I didn't take it seriously until the last year of my life. I turned 27 last year, and I just decided, is there any kids in the house? Okay, I just decided, fuck it, I'm gonna go for it. This is the year for me. And I'm inspired by people like Dominique Grant, who I went to school with, who is a community activist and organizer, who takes her passion really seriously and pursues it. I'm inspired by Tafaya, by Balu, by Natty, by so many community organizers who know that art is not just about entertainment, it's about healing, it's about community, and it's about really, as Debbie has taught me, it is our spiritual contribution to the planet, right? So spoken word is really interactive. If you feel something that you like, if you hear something that makes you want to gyrate your hips, just give me a little snap, snap. Even if you hear something that makes no sense, you know, it still takes a lot of courage to do this. So give me some love anyways, cool? Woo! Is that cool? What speaks to you? Do you exist in the breath between paint and canvas? What graffiti first illuminated your existence, the paintbrush an extension of your fingertips, the murals make your heart skip a beat, an empty alleyway whispers to you softer than a lover's invite, what speaks to you? At midnight, hunched over your desk, writing verse with an urgency that shocks your body, something electric, phosphorescent, traveling through you, moving so deep in the ink if you don't write it down fast enough, it will be trapped in the pen forever. What speaks to you? Who has djembe fire in your mouth? No matter that your mother tells you to find a real job, you know that there is something so vital about the orchestra of your mouth, the beatbox in your chest, you even hear music in the silence between the notes. You invent new ways for sound waves to puncture the indifference of your existence, that one thing that reminds you that you are more than just a bag of bones and DNA, that one thing that makes you rise every day, give thanks every day, that one thing that speaks to you. When your body unravels like ancient prophecy on the dance floor, when gravity no longer holds you back and everyone forms a circle around you to bear witness, to pay homage to the genius of you who can spin serpentine silhouette with your hips, who can pop, lock, and drop with more spark than flint against steel. Give it up for Tafaya. B-Boy Tafaya! Something sacred resurrected when you sing the blues, humming with more passion than some may experience in a lifetime, composing alchemy with baritone bass lines, the melody, morning, the coming morning that takes you to your 9 to 5, but the night. The night speaks to you of Janis Joplin, Jimi Hendrix, Nina Simone. You are the jazz that never sleeps. You are the constant cause for the neighbors threatening to call the police. Turn down the music! But how do you turn down electromagnetic waves in the current of your bloodstream? Or slow down words that tumble from your lips like a volcanic iambic lyrical helix? How do you ask your body to be still when it's a metronomic pulse to the soundtrack of your being? When the rattling can of spray paint feels like freedom, what would you not give to tag your name to that feeling? What speaks to you? Of discipline and sacrifice, of courage and commitment. For some of us, art is not a place we travel to as real life passes us by. There is a difference between a vacation and a vocation. Living for what makes you breathe, it's not a luxury, it's a necessity. They call us starving artists not because we're broke, but because we choose to stay hungry for the art that feeds us, the life force that speaks to us. And all we have to do is listen. Thank you. And to Fire Fire!
Again, that's Lee Shai Peel and also Tafaya, aka B-Boy Anansi,
representing the organization, an amazing organization called Unity Charity.
Over there? Okay, all right. Now this is really the moment that we're all here for. That was all just to like get us excited to celebrate. Okay. Can we'd like to introduce Madame Jean and Jean-Daniel Lafond to come back up here, and we're gonna announce the winner of the contest. Nous allons faire la présentation du gagnant du concours.
So pretty much we need to get a lot more energy than that, because this is the winner of all their talent, all their blood, their sweat, what they put in, what their passion is. Please make some noise for all the recipients sitting on the chair.
D'abord, je veux dire qu'ils sont tous et toutes des gagnantes et des gagnants. They are all winners. It was a national contest. We got hundreds of commissions from across Canada. The jury had it was quite a challenge, because the work was of such quality. So the jury of the Michaëlle Jean Foundation with AGO decided, first made a choice of these six, winners here, and then the public got to vote too, and to pick one for the mural that will be actually made here in AGO. But one thing that is very dear to our heart is to make sure that every single artwork become a mural. So I don't know about this result. Do you know who is the public's winner? Okay. And the winner is
Pablo Munoz.
Please make some noise for Pablo Munoz.
To the question, what can arts do? I think that every one of you here really said it right. It's about speaking out. It's really about raising awareness. It's about action for change. So Pablo, I think that the public is saying to you that it was absolutely right on your part to raise the queer, migrant, intersex, trans people of color with this work that you've done. Please.
Thank you. Oh my God, this is so beautiful. And Toronto, you are so incredibly beautiful. It's so awesome to be here, surrounded by everyone and by all my peers from across the country. I'm very honored and very proud. I've been having this conversation about solidarity and allyship for a very long time, and what it means to be an ally and what it means to stand in solidarity. And I believe that solidarity and allyship is using whatever form of privilege you have, whatever resources you have, and providing those to the people that you're standing in allyship with, so that they can tell their own stories, so that they can advocate for themselves. It's not about saving. And I feel like this project did that I was provided a platform to say what I wanted to say, and to put my art out there. And I thank the Michaëlle Jean Foundation a lot, the AGO, and everybody who put this together for this opportunity. I also thank my community a lot. on my
Make some noise for Pablo!
All the queer people of color, all those people who are currently being held in detention, we will work to get through this, and you're my inspiration. You're my inspiration to keep working and to keep finding energy to do this work. I am very thankful. I'm moving to Toronto in the fall, so please come and say hi. I know like three people here, so I'd love to know all of you. And that's it. To borrow a few words from a poet that I adore and I didn't know she was going to be here. What breaks borders, what breaks walls is love, and it's relentless love, DB. So thank you.
And we'd like to also really celebrate all of the other participants, if I can. I'm just going to call your names, and if you can stand up, because we have a little something for you. We want to celebrate them some more, yeah? So Roxanne Martin, Martin Saint-Gamal, Bogdan Sali, Leo Samilo, and Brianne Walker.
What I find absolutely wonderful is that in this room, there are people of so many different fields, backgrounds, walks of life. There are policymakers or policy shapers, decision makers, young people, artists. The word that comes to my mind first and foremost is courage. Because I think we are all here, movers and shakers. Julie, really, she just landed from New York, right? And she was here to bring her voice. And we are really gathering all our voices together to make things happen. And we believe that the arts can definitely do that. The arts are powerful for individual and collective transformation, to revitalize communities, to speak out and speak the truth and make sure that indifference really is fighted always in our society. And as so many people said here, it is a call for action. It is a call for action. This is what the arts do also. So I'm so happy and so proud of what we have achieved here. I think every time we have an opportunity, we have a venue, we have a space where we can come together and share our thoughts, our ideas, our strategies also for action, it's absolutely essential. It's essential, and we have to continue to do that. And I'm so pleased to see that AGO as a museum has created such a space where we can come in and out and speak and listen and really come together. It's absolutely wonderful. It's a shared responsibility. We have to continue to do it nonstop, and we will. Thank you.
Et nous voulons remercier Madame Jean et Jean-Daniel Lafond encore. We would like to thank again Madame Jean and Jean-Daniel Lafond.
And again, please make some noise for Pablo! Guess what?
We have our last performance!
Oh yeah, you're ready for this. Okay. So if you aren't familiar with the ballroom culture, this is something like hailing from 60s New York, Black and Latino community, LGBT community specifically. This was like a brilliant convergence of dance, getting feisty, dressing up, competing. And it's beautiful that that baton, that culture continues, sustains. There are lots of awesome ballroom houses in Toronto. If you don't know about it, you should check it out. But this is a forerunner of the ballroom community in Toronto. Get ready to make some noise for the Kiki Ballroom Alliance. Woo!
Bonjour tout le monde. hi everybody, my name is Sebastio, or Twisted in the Kiki scene or ballroom scene. I'm the founder of the Toronto Kiki Ballroom Alliance, and what the Toronto Kiki Ballroom Alliance is about is basically a whole bunch of us who are going through it because of our families. I know people have a lot of presumptions thinking that Toronto or Canada is the safest place. I was born here, I'm still not out to my family. That already should show you that it's not. Our families come from a lot of, you know, places that you would see on the news today that are very homophobic. They come to Canada, they instill the same values here, and we are born into those families. Raised in those families where we are told that the bending of the wrist is just too much, the slurring of the voice is just too much, the talking back is just too womanly, and all this stuff. So we basically had to come together our own way, which was like in the hallway at York University or at Angel's house, or and we would get together and we would vogue, and then that's kind of how it started. The TKBA took it from there. Every week we'd come to practice, more and more people started coming out because there are more and more people who are living in the same situations that we live in. So although I just want to just put that out there, like, there is a lot of work to be done here in Toronto. Yeah, so call to action. Please, when you see somebody that, you know, has a lot of religious backgrounds that are homophobic towards us, just let them know that we're people too, and all these religions promote love. So if you don't promote love, that's our answer. Well, that's my answer. So love is the way, and that's how we deal with people. So we're going to show you what we do among ourselves today. A majority of us here today do Vogue. There are six of us here. And voguing is a dance style that started in New York, extremely gay. There's just no other way of saying it. It started by us because the people in New York were facing the same thing that we were. They were being pushed out, but even more extremely than we were doing, that we're facing now. They were kicked out, killed, beaten, all these things. So then they started their ballroom scene instead of voguing in New York. The same thing happened in Toronto. We found our own scene and started creating our own scene, and we started getting our life this way. So we're going to show you how we get our life. DJ, whenever you're ready, just pump that beat. I'm going to call my friends out, and we're going to have some fun. Okay, thank you. All right, I'm going to stand on the side because I'm calling them out. Watch the talent on the floor, okay? Can I see? Oh, I know the clapping. Everybody clap for me. Come on. I said clap. Everybody clap. I said clap. Everybody clap. Ooh, clap. Everybody clap. Can I see? Just for me. Who wants to start it off? Who wants to watch? That vixen. That 007. That vixen. For your eyes only, for your eyes only. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. For your eyes only, for your eyes only. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. For your eyes only, for your eyes only. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. Ooh, give him a round of applause. All right, all right, all right. The next one. The next one. Can I see? Mock the mother. TKOO.
Monroe. For your eyes only, for your eyes only. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. For your eyes only, for your eyes only. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. For your eyes only, for your eyes only. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. It's a once-in-a-life, it's a once-in-a-life, it's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. It's a once-in-a-life, it's a once-in-a-life, it's a once-in-a-life concert. For your eyes only, for your eyes only. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. For your eyes only, give a round of applause. That, which one? All right, all right. That Tokyo, come vote for me. That Tokyo, just come vote. That Tokyo, come vote for me. The Tokyo, just come vote. Cause your eyes only, for your eyes only. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. For your eyes only, for your eyes only. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. For your eyes only, for your eyes only. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. For your eyes only, for your eyes only. It's a once-in-a-lifetime concert. Give him a round of applause. Catch the drama. Can I see just for me? Angel, angel, all come vote for me. Ooh, ooh, that angel. What? Just come vote for me. 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 Just come vote for me. Just come vote for me. Style, grace, attitude. I got it all, y'all in the mood. Style, grace, attitude. And I got it all, and I'm in the mood. Style, grace, attitude. Style, grace, attitude. Style, grace, attitude. And I got it all, and I'm in the mood. And I got it all, and I'm in the. And I got it all, and I'm in the. That style, grace, attitude. And I got it all, and I'm in the mood. Got it all, and I'm in the mood. Got it all, and I'm in the mood. Style, grace, attitude. I got it all, and I'm in the mood. Work, angel. Give him a round. Work, angel. Style, grace, attitude. I got it all, and I'm in the mood. I like that chat. I like it. Okay. Can I see Snoopy? From So You Think You Can Dance Canada. That's Snoopy. That 007. That's Snoopy. What? Style, grace, attitude. I got it all and I'm in the mood. Style, grace, attitude. I got it all and I'm in the mood. Style, grace, attitude. I got it all and I'm in the mood. Style, grace, attitude. I got it all and I'm in the mood. Style, grace, attitude. I got it all and I'm in the. I got it all and I'm in the. I got it all and I'm in the. Style, grace, attitude. I got it all and I'm in the. Style, grace, attitude. I got it all and I'm in the. Style, grace, attitude. I got it all and I'm in the. 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 Work, Snoopy.
Said clap, people clap. I said. Bring it back, bring it back. Bring it back, bring it back. Right on beat, right on beat. Let's go, let's go. Let's go, let's go. Said I got that style, grace, attitude. I'm feeling it, I'm in the mood. That style, grace, attitude. I'm feeling it in the mood. That style, grace, attitude. I've got it all and I'm in the mood. That style, grace, attitude. I've got it all and I'm in the mood. Style, grace, attitude. I've got it all and I'm in the mood. That style, grace, attitude. I've got it all and I'm in the mood. Style, grace, attitude. I've got it all and I'm in the mood. That style, grace, attitude. I've got it all and I'm in the. Style, grace, attitude. I've got it all and I'm in the mood. That style, grace, attitude. I've got it all and I'm in the mood. Mood. I'm in the mood. Mood. Give him a round of applause. Call them back to the stage, take a bow. Snoopy, Snoopy. Thank you, thank you. We're the TKBA. Vixen, Vixen. Twisted, Twisted. Tokyo, Tokyo. Snoopy, Snoopy. Angel, Angel. TKO. Style, grace, attitude. We got it all. We're in the mood. Style, grace, attitude. We got it all. We're in that.
Make some noise again for the Kiki Ballroom Alliance!
I'm Carrie. I'm Cyrus. We just want to thank everybody for coming today. Our food and beverage department has made a delicious array of rainbow-related food and beverages over there. They said that they were going to surprise us. We had no idea how colorful they were going to get.
And we are very surprised. So please stay around, join us, celebrate, network, and thanks again for coming. What a wonderful afternoon.
Thank you. Thank you, Madame Jean. Thank you, Monsieur Lafond. Thank you, Natty. Thank you, Balu. Thank you to all of the artists.
Woo-hoo! Feel free to talk amongst yourselves. The conversation doesn't stop at this event. Woo!
Okay, and cutting to slide, and cutting camera to nearby.
Thank you everyone for joining us at the Youth Solidarity Forum at the Art Gallery of Ontario in coordination with Michaëlle Jean Foundation and World Pride. Thank you so much everyone for coming. We had such a wonderful day. We saw so many amazing performances and had so many inspirational and creative speakers come and talk to us. It was really a touching day. And I hope everyone enjoyed it, and I hope everyone is able to embrace all people regardless of what place they fall on the gender or sexuality spectrum. So thank you everyone for coming, and please come again.
Black. Yeah.